Hello, welcome to this video on avian anatomy. In this video you will see a dissection of chicken, a bird, that's done by a very eminent avian anatomist, Dr. Evans. And I am very much thankful for granting permission by Dr. Evans and Dr. Tom Ayre for making this video. Hope you will enjoy it, and also do look for the other series of videos that have been prepared and uploaded by me on the net, and the other videos that I have embedded from net from other sites. Thank you very much.
We want everybody to appreciate what's in the dish, and everybody should also see in the dish. The condition is a spot that looks around us, is moving all the time from muscular action. And the individual discovers an egg, but you congregate, it starts hovering over that egg, it starts to pop out of the ovary. And when the egg starts to pop out, it actually bulges. The egg bulges through and it gets swallowed as it's bulging through. If you watch it on a mesotype bird, you can watch how the ovation takes place. They're very slow. And then in here, I put a table in there of how long it takes along the track. Or also, sorry, how old is it? I'm 37, and the suggestion behind the set. The one that looks at on page 14. On page 14 shows you the approximate time that an egg takes to travel through the length of the oviduct. And when they open up, it's so convoluted that it's hard to imagine the part, but individual is easy because that's the beginning point. The maximum distance can be quite far, actually. It's not very hard, it's fine between them, but it's not worth searching. And in a shell plant, it's 20 hours. So it takes 20 hours to put a shell down. And that's something that we want to see. So for starting with the section, the big thing about this, why don't I just start chicken, and we'll talk about it as we do it. Oh, you are, all the chickens already lying flat. That's part of the secret. You get the chicken to lie flat on its back. So what Dr. Ivory did is he opened up the skin over the breast and he cut it toward the leg on each side. And then he bent the leg back and disarticulated it to him. That doesn't hurt the bird a bit. And once you do that, the bird no longer rocks around on the table to fly.
Like that, maybe they fed these chickens.
So. Yeah.
It's much easier to see the crop when it's full.
Yeah.
See that crop? That crop is full. Now, the chicken, when it eats its food, often eats pebbles along with it, or grit. And grit is oyster shell. And the purpose of the grit or oyster shell is to help the chicken grind it when it gets into the gizzard. And here we see the esophagus right here. That's esophagus and the trachea. And along the trachea, there's a muscle on each side of the trachea. The lateral tracheal muscles run down. They're going all the way down to the syrinx, which is the voice-producing box just within the thoracic inlet. Now, you'll find a lot of fat on these chickens, and that means it's a healthy chicken. So we don't object to the fat. Yeah, this is a good omen, you know? Yeah, when you see, oh, this is a good chicken. What you try to do is you see where the esophagus comes into the crop, and then the esophagus leaves the crop again to go into the stomach. So the crop is really just a diverticulum or a bulging of the esophagus. And whenever you come across the fat, you can take the fat off. Yeah, see how this bird lies down? It's been well disarticulated. This is very good. Oh, you might look at the cloaca early on. The cloaca, is that showing up here? The cloaca has the oviduct. Left oviduct is the one producing the egg. And it usually shows up, if you can dilate it. This one, I'm not very successful at showing you that. But we can, well, the cloaca has all the openings in it. Usually you can feel the egg coming down too. I don't feel the egg in this one. The cloaca has the right and left oviducts entering, but it's only the left oviduct that's functional. So the right one will be very small. The right one will be over here. And sometimes, instead of being a shrunken little sac, it's expanded with fluid, which is typical of some hollow organ that doesn't develop. In other words, it's vestigial, the right oviduct in a chicken. In some hawks, the right oviduct is full size. Well now, this is the big pectoralis muscle, that whole muscle. And it's the muscle used for the downbeat. So it's the biggest flight muscle that we have in the bird. And it can separate, you can separate it from the supracoracoideus, which is deeper. And the thing to do is to separate it all the way down along the furcula. Remember the wishbone here. Right like that. And here we are. You see the supracoracoideus showing up right here. This is all pectoralis. It used to be called superficial pectoral and deep pectoral. So if you look in an old book, you may see them speaking of deep pectoral and superficial pectoral. But we now call it supracoracoideus instead of deep pectoral. And the reason for that is it goes through a foramen, the supracoracoid muscle. Oh, here we have an interesting little thing. Right here. You notice this membrane here? Does that membrane show up? It's a membrane right there. Oh. Now that was the scalp. That membrane is the air sac of the... That air sac is the axillary diverticulum of a clavicular air sac. So the air that's coming in and going into the humerus goes through that diverticulum. And if you blow smoke into the trachea, you would see it show up there. Now, what we want to do, we're not going to follow the muscle to the point, well, we could, you know, if you want to follow the muscle through, remove the pectoralis muscle, you could remove it and see that it's causing the downbeat of the wing. We're taking it off the zifisternal processes here. And you can free it all the way and then actually pull on that muscle and see how it pulls the wing down for the downbeat. Then you can free the supracoracoideus and try to follow its tendon. We have a skeleton out here, and you should be able to see where the tendon of the supracoracoid muscle goes through what used to be called the foramen triosseum. And the foramen triosseum is where the three bones come together. The scapula and the coracoid and the clavicle come together and form a foramen. And it's through that foramen that the tendon of the supracoracoideus passes to go to the top side of the humerus. And by going to the top side of the humerus, when this muscle contracts, the wing is raised. So in other words, the muscle for raising the wing and lowering the wing are on top of each other on the breast. And really, the breast muscle is about 1/5 of the muscle weight of the chicken. So it's a very strong muscle. So now what you want to do is get inside the abdomen by this one already open a little bit. Open it up with a scissors or a scalpel. And once you're in there, I think I prefer the scissors here. We're going to go cut right through the ribs on each side. Try to avoid the liver. Cut through the ribs. And you're not going to be able to avoid all the blood vessels. The heart is attached by a ligament to the sternum here. We'll cut that free. That's the liver. And it'll get bloody, you know, to varying degrees. Yeah, and then if you have to, just wash it off in the sink. That's good. I think we can take that right off. Yeah, that's probably, why don't I come right in like that. I cut through the clavicle. we just lift that up like that. We don't want to open the crop if we can help it. Okay. Thank you. Now you see the heart sitting right there. You could flush it off if you want to. Each bird will open up a little differently. And this bird head already has some hemorrhaging in here. I don't know why that was. I mean, we didn't do that. It may be in the when the bird was being put out. Yeah. And here we see a muscle going to the side, to the trachea, lateral trachea muscle. Now, at this point, you might want to remove the extra fat. You know, someone who's using it as a stewing hen or a cooking hen is very happy when they see all this fat because it can render into good chicken fat for cooking. For us, it just gets in the way. But it means that this is a healthy bird. So you can free the fat in great big patches and have it come off. And this is the gizzard that I'm uncovering right now. There's the gizzard. And the gizzard is only one half of the stomach. There are two parts of the stomach, proventriculus and the ventriculus. And the ventriculus is usually called gizzard. And the proventriculus is usually neglected. Nobody pays any attention to it. Yet the proventriculus is what has the gastric secretions. The pepsin and the HCl is secreted into this proventriculus, and there it is right there. The proventriculus is this structure, and the gizzard is this structure. Now, what we'd like you to do at some point in the dissection, you don't have to do it right away, but at some point in the dissection, you're going to open the gizzard up, and get the scissors into the gizzard, and go right up into the proventriculus, like this. And when you open up the proventriculus, the first thing you see are the papillae of the glands that secrete both the HCl and the pepsin. Those are the papillae. And I might say that the papillae in the proventriculus is different than different birds. In some birds, it's a strip across. In other birds, it's at the rostral end, and others at the caudal end. So it differs. Now, depending on what the bird ate, sometimes they're eating grass and just empty the gizzard out. This is what is being chewed in here. And the gizzard has a series of muscles that can pull it in several directions, and they alternate the direction to grind the food. And the more pebbles that are in there, the better it gets ground. Now the grinding action in the gizzard would injure the lining of the gizzard if it weren't covered with something. So it is covered by a layer of material. I'm going to pull that off. This layer of material is called coilin, K-O-I-L-I-N, coilin. And coilin is a protein carbohydrate combination. Here it comes off. And it's produced by glands in the gizzard. So to say that the gizzard is non-glandular isn't really true. It doesn't have digestive glands, it's true. But it has these protective glands here producing this lining called coilin. Yeah. In a supermarket, when they are going to put the gizzard in a bag to go to make giblet gravy, so that's the lining of the gizzard. And it's secreted all the time. Oh.
Want to see? Okay. All right.
Now that lining. It's being secreted all the time as the bird grinds the food up. I see I missed a little piece here. Oh, there it is. And then, of course, the pepsin and CO and HCl have gone in with the food and are being ground up. And then it passes into the duodenum. And the duodenum in all birds is fairly the same. It's a characteristic sort of structure. The duodenum has the pancreas in the loop. This is a good, this fat body is really organized. Fat bodies in birds are so organized that they're almost considered like organs. Some people name the fat bodies. But careful, yeah, I don't want to do a dental loop. These are the cecae that are showing up. Might as well look at them since it's right here. That cecum is coming all the way from where the small intestine joined the large intestine. These are the two ends of the cecae, and they're filling up with gas a bit. The cecae are dead-end appendages that are full of bacteria that digest the food. Every once in a while, the cecum empties back into the intestine. So those are the two cecae. And when they swell up and are full of gas, they sometimes get very smelly. I'm looking right now for the duodenal loop, which is one of the most characteristic features. For some reason or other, that's large intestine. See the large intestine here, and there's a cecae come off there. Yeah, and there's the duodenal loop right here. Now the middle of the duodenal loop is the pancreas. The pancreas in almost every bird lies within the duodenal loop. I don't know any bird where it doesn't. So it's very easy to find the pancreas in a bird. And this duodenal loop is always quite characteristic too. It's closest to the surface. Now if we just put those to one side, the viscera, and we look here, oh, I see what we have here. We have an egg here in the shell gland, but it hasn't got any shell. It's just all plumped, and it has the membranes on it. You'll notice all the blood vessels coming into this part. They call this part of the oviduct the uterus, but it's really not the uterus in a technical sense, but in birds they call the lower end of the oviduct the uterus. And it stays in that shell gland quite a while, getting the shell. There's no shell on this one. And it all depends when it started through in the bird. Now, if we open this up a little more, oh, and here we see the spleen. That's the spleen right there. The spleen always is alongside the proventriculus. So if you're looking for the spleen, there's the proventriculus, and the spleen is attached very close to it. And here is an egg in the ovary. These eggs are all in the ovary. So it looks like this is tomorrow's egg right here. And you see that line across it? That's the stigma. The stigma is that yellow line caused by the fact that the capillaries don't cross there. If we knew what keeps them from crossing, it would be very useful for preventing angiogenesis. They're very interested in cancer studies, in ways to inhibit angiogenesis, the development of blood vessels. And I never heard of anybody working on the stigma of birds to find out why it discourages blood vessels to develop. I think you'll hear that kind of thing in the future because it's being worked on very hard. In cancer research. Now what we want to see at the upper end of the oviduct, and here's the oviduct, the magnum and the isthmus. And when you come up here, you see this ligament right here, and that ligament is holding the infundibulum up at this end. And what we want to find is the infundibulum is there. I'm holding it right now. Does that show up, this funnel? There's the funnel right here. And that diary is going to put a probe into the infundibulum.
On that side.
Yeah, I think it's very flimsy. Yeah. Ah, there it is. Look at that. Yeah, right there. So this infundibulum, where the probe is, actually comes over the egg and swallows it like a snake. It swallows it like a snake. And if you wanted to put something in there, like a message to a retiring poultry man, you can open up the bird, just make a slit in the bird, and slip the message in there, and it'll come down in an eggshell, and boil the egg, and present the egg to him as the retirement, or whatever. I never saw it happen, I heard about that happen. And of course, anything you slip into the abdomen at a time of ovulation will be picked up along with the yolk and passed through. So if you slip a diamond into the abdomen, the diamond will be picked up also, and then you can smuggle it through in an egg. Look over the egg. It's inside the egg. It's probably been done. Yeah. I think at this point it probably is a good idea. Oh, let's see, one more thing we can say. When you get through in the abdomen and you go up the neck, you don't have, we want to open it up all the way here. Okay. And when we open it up, we want to see the hyoid apparatus. That's the apparatus that pulls the tongue in and out. And the tongue of birds, the chicken doesn't stick its tongue out very far. The woodpecker sticks it out a long way. So the woodpecker's hyoids go right over the top of the head into the nostrils. Consists of two horns. Here it is up here also. There's one way, you know what we could do? We could open it up and grab the tongue and let me pull the tongue in and out. I'm going to open the mouth. Let me cut the, yeah, do like that and do like that. And there's the tongue right there. Yeah. And you notice when the tongue is pulled in and out, we'll see the hyoid apparatus up here. Yeah, it doesn't want to do it. So let's just open up, let's take off the lower jaw. I'll take it off like that. Yeah, and pull it out. Now here we see the tongue itself, and we see the larynx behind it. That's the larynx. The opening to the larynx is called the glottis. The glottis is the opening to the larynx. So now that we have that open, and here are the hyoid horns. If we pull this all the way out, and we'll just pull this free. There, how's that? Does that show up? Those two horns?
The fangs of his neck.
Yeah. Yeah, those are the hyoid horns, and they're attached to the tongue, and there are muscles on them, so those muscles can pull the tongue in and out. And then the woodpecker goes up over the top of the head into the nostrils sometimes. Yeah, the respiratory path in the bird, that's the coene here, going in, air goes in there. I think that's probably at this point. We'll go around, we'll all go around the tables, as you just said, and ask questions as we go around. So,